What's up, guys? We're back here at the GSL Code S. We just witnessed Party kicking a lot of ass.
Yeah, he kind of smacked Myung's chick up. It was pretty one-sided. So, Party goes on that winner's match, whereas Myung-sik awaits the loser of this next match. It's going to be True against Bbyong. And I was actually thinking a lot on the subway ride here about Bbyong's chances in the group. And I feel like he kind of got the rough end. If he played a Protoss first, I would give him a much higher chance to get out. But this is actually really tough because True is a Zerg player who is very willing to do crazy all-ins, like really cheesy play.
Well, it's one of these players that it's really, really, really hard to predict because he is an aggressive, crazy Zerg. He's not the Zerg that's like, well, you know, when do I get my hype tech and how do I do this properly? And when you get somebody aggressive like that, even if you know what they're going to do, or the basic premise, like he might do an all-in, he might do a timing, it can still be very difficult to stop.
And the thing is, True could just play a macro game. Like, I think he's going to play pretty cheesy overall, but the fact that Bbyong has to prepare for that as his first match and then go through possibly two Protosses is like, I don't know. It's just, I feel like he had a very tough starting match for the group. If I was him, I would much prefer to have played a Protoss to start.
Young chick, ideally.
Yeah, something like that.
Let's see how he does here. I mean, for all of our Terran players watching, this is like one of the last chances you might have to learn Terran here at GOM.
This guy is the albino koala of this season.
He is. He is like the, what is it, the white rhino or something? Going extinct here.
Yeah.
Not many of them left.
I'm gonna get a Bbyong Tusk piano. What? anyways.
Bbyong Tusk piano.
Yes. Well, no, that would be an elephant, not a rhino. What do you make out of rhinos?
That's just a good question.
What terrible
souvenir. Do they actually use the horn?
Oh, isn't that supposed to be, like, something that helps with sex or something?
I thought that was tiger penis.
It's probably that, too, yeah. But I think it's a horn of rhinos, too. I'm pretty sure.
Otherwise, I don't know what... I was thinking of a joke, but I can't. I probably can't say this joke on TV. Which would be, The rhino's horn is, in fact, made out of hair.
Yes, it's a modified hair.
Yeah, modified hair. Wow, this is one of the only times that I get to drop the animal knowledge bomb before you.
Well, I thought everyone knew that already. It's just so commonly known, right?
No, it's not.
Oh, it's not?
Not guy at home who didn't think so until you said that.
Yeah, I guess so.
Our first map is going to be Polar Knight. Wait, what are they? I don't think the rhino tusk is used for fertility medicine.
I think it is.
Is it? Really?
Yeah.
What else do they use the rhino for? Is it just hunted because it's like a big animal that's hard to kill?
Well, like, is it just like, I think it used to be sport? Like, I think it used to be hunted for sport, like back in, you know, the 20s or something, but like...
You can still hunt rhinos for sport.
Can you?
Yeah, it's really actually messed up. There's like an endangered rhino foundation that, like, if you donate enough money to let you hunt them, but the money goes to like help the rhinos.
Wow, that's really weird.
Yeah. But those rhinos won't be around for long. I think they're all going to be fights in about 30 years. The more you
Thank
learn
God.
Here in the GSL Code S. When my head says
no, I'm ready to go. True versus Bbyong.
So tasteless.
What's up, man?
Last few days, I've been a bit sick. Yesterday, I was actually
feeling
really
sick. I wanted to hang out with you a little bit, and I couldn't.
Yeah, I'm sorry about that, but I'm starting to feel a little bit better here today.
Mm-hmm.
How are you doing, though?
I'm doing good, man.
Yeah?
I streamed Starbo yesterday.
It's a fun game.
Like 6.5 hours or something.
Sick? We got to play.
Yeah, we got to play for sure.
Yeah.
It's a good game. I really enjoy it.
Yeah, it's really fun. Maybe next week we can play some games.
Yeah, for sure, man.
Okay, so here we are, Tasteless, Polar Knight, Bbyong against True.
I'm really hoping that Bbyong, for Terran's sake, can get far in this tournament because... When it all comes down to Maru, man, that's a tall order, too.
Well, Maru has wide shoulders, Tasteless. He can take the load.
Here is the hatchery coming down here. And it's going to be a little bit. They're just getting everything set up. We have Terran going for gas, early gas here. So, in the meanwhile, we're just going to color in that hot six bottle.
Yeah.
Some Michael Bay special effects there.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, probably grab a Reaper out here pretty quickly, and you know.
You've only played Terran in Starbo, right? You didn't play Protoss?
No. Why would I touch inferior races when one race has a Vulture and Siege tanks that actually work?
Vultures are pretty good, man. How do you feel about the way the Vultures lay mines in Starbo?
The cooldown is stupid.
How long is the cooldown?
It's longer than it should be, because I did my, like, it instantly came back to me how I used to, like, spread my Vultures and lay, like, 400 mines in 2 seconds. And,
weird,
like,
the thing I felt was weird about the Vultures at Starbo when I watched them lay mines was simply that the mines laid so easily.
Oh, yeah, there's never any glitching. That might be part of the reason why they did that, but, like, you can overcome glitching with good play. Like,
the
Vultures. Like, I know how to not glitch Vultures while laying mines. You know?
Exactly. But I've just, for me, it was weird because I've watched them come up and just lay 6 mines very neatly.
Yeah.
I'm like, whoa, that's.
Yeah.
I'm actually used to Brood War where they only one of them would lay a mine in the group until after that. Then you get them all working together. And here's the Reaper coming up here now.
I'm seeing a Reaper being made as well. Some Lings and a couple Queens being made here for True.
And it looks like he's just going to get a little bit of scouting here, harass some of these Lings.
And I've got to say, I do like that he opened with a Reaper here, or two Reapers rather, because this is going to allow him to scout a little bit more. And as I said, True is a player that definitely does play kind of a cheesy style. Like, I don't know exactly what he's going to be doing here against Bbyong, but it could be a pretty wide range of strats. Like, he could go for some sort of Baneling Roach Bust. He could just, he could stay off of actual tech use and go Ling Bane for a bit. Like, there's a lot of different ways that he can play this. So, it's good that there's a lot of scouting going on from Bbyong right now.
Yeah, it's definitely the best way to try to deal with a player who actually is very good at a lot of things and kill people very quickly here.
Yeah.
Now we have this nice harass here by Bbyong. I actually don't expect him to attack the queen that much. I don't even know if that was quite. I mean, I guess they're going to regen anyways, but so that was pretty intense harasser on that queen.
Yeah, and by the way, he is getting triple command and getting a factory up and all, but
and that's been spotted, by the way.
He went 3 Reaper, which is kind of neat, because a lot of times you see 2 Reaper with one doing the scouting and harassment and the other one sitting at home for a bit to make sure Lings don't try to run by and mess you up because you have no Marines. But this time he's made the third to do that, so he could actually harass heavily with 2. And he almost got a queen, as we saw, so it's going all right.
And the orbital is just now finishing up. And it looks like Bbyong's just going to play very defensive from here.
Yeah.
Getting that starport up, letting that tech lab finish.
I wonder if he's going to end up going mech.
I would love to see him go mech. Do you think mech is actually strong enough on this map, though?
Yeah, I think it's fine on this map.
Yeah. I guess with the fourth, very easy to still take. After the third, both of them.
Yeah,
not hard to hold.
I guess that is true, but just kind of like the map isn't too big, you know. And even on a big map, like I think it's fine on Frost as well. Well, generally speaking, I think it's basically fine anywhere. But I think it's a good strat. We'll see if he actually ends up going for that. And we do have a plume of Lings being made by True right now, and I think that this is just a nod towards the fact that he sees that there's like a bunch of Hellions and Reapers out, so he needs enough Lings to overwhelm anything that comes towards his third base.
And those Lings are now going to move out here. Looks like they might be going over here to the upper left so that if, let's say, Hellions and the Reapers come out, he can come up from behind and tag them that way.
Yeah, I really like that. In fact, I think we're going to see a little counterattack here coming up. By the way, a couple Widow Mines being made very quickly here, so that's interesting as
well. He's just going to keep those at home for defense and in case of a counterattack, or is he going to move out with them? It looks like they're rallied just to the entrance to the second base.
Well, this would make a lot of sense if he has a couple Widow Mines just sitting at home because of how True oftentimes does play. Now, you have these Lings starting to come up, looking for a flank.
And it looks like it's going to be going for bio here. We see Stim being started, Vikings now being produced.
That's right, a couple of eBays going up.
Yep.
So unless he's getting Stim for like 7 Marines and going upgrades for missile turrets and building armor right away, then yeah, I would say you're right, this is going to be bio.
So
probably not that, right?
Probably not. Nice job there assassinating the Queen and the main for True. And the Banshee goes ahead and backs out.
He hasn't really killed that much this game, though. You know,
a couple
of drones, a queen, not that big a deal. Right now, we do have a spire coming up for True here.
And the barracks explosion occurring here now for Bbyong as his economy's really kicked in here. And now we might have a sandwich. Looks like he's going to get maybe just about half of this. Yep, nice cast there. And even one of the Reapers not getting away.
Well, that was actually
pretty cost-effective.
Yeah, it certainly was, and that kind of takes away all map control from Bbyong. You know, he really wanted to be out there and be able to keep the Lings back and maybe force extra units and stuff. But
and you got to look at the value there. I mean, that was mineral-only units taking out gas gas mineral units there, too.
Mm.
You know, and just driving them back, more expensive units as well. So now we have the double E-bays just continuing to upgrade here, and this is a lot of barracks right now
as
he takes the third.
That's true.
Production's going to kick in really heavily here for Bbyong. And he's actually taking that base that's out there in the front, which is going to be pretty convenient for him when he wants to start to push. He'll probably be pushing up over that hill towards Zerg's third at the far right.
It is one of the nice things about it. But if you look at how Zerg has spread his creep, he spread it towards a place that he can easily take as like a fourth or maybe a fifth, because he is clearing those rocks in the back. But that also allows him to go down a counterattack route a little bit quicker, because the third base is going to be really covered, as that is the attack path towards Zerg. But the natural might be a little bit more open.
So,
interesting place for those, huh?
It is, actually.
It's like, well, I'm going to put these here just in case I lose my third. I also can't have any upgrades.
I was going to say, then I actually just lose the game.
Yeah.
Normally we would see those tucked into the main there, but...
Well, you know what? On this map, with how it's shaped and stuff, maybe he's thinking, you know what? If I lose this area, the game's over anyways, whereas if I lose my main, it's maybe not as big a deal. Because, like, that third base is literally guarding the fourth, and it's, like, his rally point. You know, I get it.
Well, the mutas are coming in now. It looks like the third is not really defended here from air, and they're going to take out some SCVs. Also, the base is a bit cluttered, so it's not easy for these Marines to get over here. So these mutas so far are doing a lot of damage, even though they're very small in numbers here.
Yeah, it's really not many, but look at that. He's actually killed quite a bit already with them.
Might even get that meta back.
Oh, man.
Oh, okay, he does actually get that away. And
still,
we're talking about five mutas. That was all
those
it
like
took
StarCraft
to do a good
1
amount
mutas right there,
yeah, man.
Not since StarCraft 1 have I seen five mutas do that type of damage.
And he's got many more mutas that he's made now. It does look like the push is beginning here for Bbyong.
Well, a lot of Lings, a lot of Banes. Well, not too many Banes actually on the way right now. We do have some mines coming up being spread out. But we're going to have a gigantic flank, it looks like, Taze. I can't imagine that Bbyong's army's going to look through this.
And he is going to come here from behind. Hopefully these Widow Mines will help. But instead, the Lings of Mutas now headed southbound here.
Ooh.
To engage the reinforcements. These Marines completely useless without the medevacs there.
That is true, but at the same time, part of his Ling group actually went up towards the rest of the army, did get cleaned up, and now we have the Mutas getting flanked here for a moment. He will lose a little bit.
Now Bbyong's going to be able to regroup here. Let's see if he can push any further. A lot more Lings and Banelings being produced.
No, I really liked how he decided to go down towards the rallying in units there.
Yeah, that was really good.
The way that he only brought part of his units with it, he didn't overwhelm it as much as he could have, and he lost the other half of his Lings. So
yeah.
I think it was like a little bit indecisive here by True.
And now it looks like the push is going to continue again here. He wants to get where those Widow Mines are so that he can be properly covered. Then he's going to spread out and engage. I'm not sure if True's entirely prepared for this. It seemed like those Banelings were fished in pretty easily.
Yeah, that was not the greatest Baneling connections I've ever seen.
I mean, this is where a lot of his tech is right here. So he has to control this location. He cannot afford to lose this, or he will essentially lose this game.
That's so correct. If he takes this down...
Did he get the Baneling Nest? Is that just above us?
Yeah, he did get the Baneling Nest, it looks like. And, well, those 1-1 upgrades at least finished, so that's good. But, like, already, True has lost everything.
And
not really the most impressive game from True, to be honest.
No, not really.
Very strong play from Bbyong, though. Really quick economy, good control. His harassment really wasn't the best, but, you know, he just kind of, he tightened everything up, closed all his walls, made some bunkers, had some defensive Widow Mines, and True wasn't able to do really much of anything this game.
Yeah, he was pretty impotent this entire game.
Yeah.
I like the ideas behind some of the stuff he was doing, but when it came to the implementation, it wasn't very impressive at all.
Like, I really liked how he made Plumalings and was able to surround some Hellions, but
you
got to remember, that means less drones, and Bbyong really drives it home that game. It's seemingly easy victory for him.
Yeah, pretty textbook win there.
Yeah.
Nothing really extraordinary from Bbyong. It was just very solid, nice play.
Yeah.
He had good control. He made good decisions. He teched properly. He had the upgrades, and it allowed him to win.
Well, that's going to be a big weight off his shoulders that game, I think.
Yeah.
He came here into a group where there's two Protoss players that kind of outshine the Zerg, but the Zerg is a little bit cheesy, which makes it scary.
Yeah.
And to win that first game kind of easily, I don't know what True has planned yet next, but I don't know. It has to be better than what we just saw for sure.
Well, I'm wondering if True's going to revert back to some of his more aggro-style plays.
I feel like that was kind of an aggro-style play, the way that he had all those